Discovery Channel and the Chrysler Corporation are proud to bring you the best in quality documentary television. This presentation of The Brain is presented in partnership with Chrysler Plymouth and Jeep Eagle, divisions of the Chrysler Corporation.
From a remote corner of Western Asia comes a story of the rise of consciousness in the human brain. This is northern Iraq. Beyond its rivers and rocky slopes lie the plains. Here, a remarkable group of human fossils rested undisturbed for 60,000 years. Today, the American anthropologist who discovered those bones returns, worried that ethnic wars have put the excavation site in jeopardy. 40 years ago, Dr. Ralph Selecki, then at Columbia University, explored the caves at Shanidar, where he unearthed an image of ancient man that profoundly changed the way we saw our ancestors. The professor discovered this skull. It belonged to Neanderthal man. Strangely, the skull was covered with microscopic pollen from the flowers of thistle, ground seal, spirea, and hollyhock, among others. The same pollen dust covered the rest of the weathered skeleton, suggesting that his family and friends had deliberately gathered the flowers and laid them in bunches on the dead body. These mourners left behind the earliest known signs of man's awareness of death. This is a model of a Neanderthal skull from Shanidar. Put him in a suit today, and he could probably pass for a hairy human. Poor fellow. We wish we knew you better. We do know this much. Based on Dr. Selecki's findings, Neanderthal seemed to possess what we've come to call a mind. By itself, the mind tends to defy definition. It helps when we can name some of its attributes. Introspection, empathy, a sense of past and future, reflection, an inner voice. Now, we can't really say when the mind suddenly popped up on the evolutionary scene. Certainly, the burial site at Shanidar indicates an early grasp of symbolic meaning and ritual. But the search for the mind's origins is really twofold. It involves time, when did it appear, and space. Where exactly is it anyway? Is it here? This is where we point when we ask ourselves, am I losing my mind? Or maybe it's all in my head. But all that's inside here that we know of is our brain. I'm David Suzuki. In our search for the mind, we're about to begin a journey into the most complex structure in the known universe, the human brain.
Like most things, it had a rather humble beginning, but the result was nothing short of a masterpiece.
Thank you.
The return trip to the Shanidar Caves was not an easy one, despite the placid rural setting. Kurdish rebels and the Iraqi military were clashing fiercely along the hillsides and beyond. Grim remnants of war littered the roadside. Nearly half a century has passed since Dr. Solecki last set eyes on this cave. As he approached, he crossed fields of the very wildflowers the Neanderthals once placed on their gravesites. Upon reaching the entrance, Dr. Solecki was flooded with the memories of what he had once discovered inside.
This is my old excavation from 40 years ago, over 40 years ago, of Shanidar Cave. As you see, the situation was changed over the years because the local people, the herders with their animals, have dumped their debris in the pit. This pit has about 9 meters of deposits on the bedrock. Now, in this cave, we have found 9 Neanderthals, of which 2 are most important. Number 1, found over there at the depth of about 5 meters. And one here, Shanidar 4, found at a depth of about 7 meters. Number 1 was special because he was a man about 40 years old who had his arm cut off, perhaps with stone tools. And also he was blind in the left eye and he had rheumatism. And he's probably not very well good at hunting, so perhaps they kept him at home to tend fires.
It was a remarkable find. It meant that Neanderthals cared for their physically disabled. Once dubbed brutish and backward, Neanderthals were actually creatures of compassion. Nearby lay other burial sites. Dr. Solecki found large amounts of pollen covering the upper half of these skeletal remains.
We had found pollens extracted from the soil, something like this, and these pollens indicate the 8 types of flowers which we think were interred with the individual, and this seems to indicate perhaps the first signs of spiritual evolution and maybe the first stirrings of religion, something unknown before in the life of the Neanderthals.
These bones help piece together a puzzle, not of our human origins, but of the origins of our humanity. For the first time in the archaeological record, the burial sites of Shanidar revealed a poignant human awareness of our situation. They marked the rise of human consciousness. Perhaps not coincidentally, this evolving consciousness corresponded to the evolving brain. The brain was born in the primordial seas some 500 million years ago. And every creature under the sun, from frigate birds to physicists, evolved from this same humble start. Eons would pass before evolution began its march across the land. As new life forms evolved, so did the brain. amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals. Millions of species arriving over millions of years. For much of its time on Earth, the brain was a rather simple machine, overseeing a scrappy paw-to-jaw existence. But with each passing of age, the brain added new parts on top of the old, almost hodgepodge. Every new addition brought new skills and ingenuity. The brain's prototype developed here, in the first primitive sea creatures, like this sea squirt. Its simple nervous system is little more than a set of specialized cells crackling with electricity. Within the sea squirt's embryo, these cells form a tube, shown in pink. In more highly evolved animals, this tube eventually grows into a brain. Here's a view of the neural tube under an electron microscope. The nerve cells, or neurons, are neatly arranged along the walls of the tube. A mere 300 neurons are all the sea squirt needs to orient itself to light and swim through the water. As far as we know, the first actual brain existed in this ancient fish. The number of neurons increased, and small swellings formed along the neural tube, just the barest traces of a brain. Cell structure also changed drastically. Insulating sheaths formed around the branches of neurons. These sheaths act like conductors, speeding up the electrical signals between neurons to rates nearing 270 miles per hour. This amazing footage shows a sheath forming around a neuron. As fish evolved into amphibians, then reptiles, the brain underwent further expansion. The dinosaurs possessed the unique structure we've come to call the reptilian brain. All reptiles and mammals have inherited this crude piece of hardware. With the emergence of the reptile, the brain acquired the skills needed by the animal to survive on land. The reptilian brain was soon overshadowed, literally, by the mammalian brain. Shown in blue, the mammalian brain grew rapidly in response to increasing demands from the environment. We call this mammalian brain the cerebrum. It's covered by a thin, wrinkled layer called the cortex. The cortex may have been a byproduct of the Ice Age. As a deep freeze descended, it tested the brain's limits. Animals with a cortex could respond more intelligently and had a better chance at survival. Then, about 5 million years ago, the cortex appeared in a new kind of mammal, early man. This cortex looked different. For one thing, there was more of it. And its surface was organized into columns, thousands and thousands of them, each less than a millimeter wide. Each column housed a set of the brain's building blocks, the neurons. With their extended fibers, These neurons built communication lines, sending each other messages at amazing speeds. These were the columns of experience. Incoming information about the outside world poured through here for filtering and processing. And these columns, with their intricate nerve cell circuits, also allowed for memory storage, for learning, for planning, something nearly unprecedented in the animal kingdom. These nerve cells multiplied, and the cortex swelled in size. Within the confines of the skull, the cortex was forced to fold in on itself, creating mountains and valleys. The elaborate creases came to be recognized as uniquely human. As it happened, this human brain evolved rapidly, almost instantaneously on the geological timescale. 5 million years ago, the first model of this brain appeared on the African savanna. It weighed less than a pound. But within 3 million years, early hominids were making tools. This is the skull of Homo habilis. His name means toolmaker or handyman. His brain was about half a pound heavier than his ancestors. Another million years passed, and Homo habilis gave way to Homo erectus. He discovered fire and hunting. The human brain had now nearly doubled in size. Then, about 100,000 years ago, modern man arrived, Homo sapiens, with a brain weighing in at a whopping 3 pounds. The brain of Homo sapiens was nearly 4 times larger and 3 times heavier than its prototype of just a few million years before. It's the same brain we use today. Structurally and anatomically, it hasn't changed much. Underneath the newfangled cortex, the brainstem, the limbic system, and the basal ganglia date back to the mastodons, the dinosaurs, and the first amphibians. In humans, the old parts of the brain oversee emotion and help build memories. They control heart rate and breathing. They also form intimate connections with the new brain, the cortex. Meanwhile, the cortex collects experience and life's lessons in the form of neural circuits. The cortex calls on these circuits to modulate the influence of this emotional, impulsive side of our brains, so that we might act like citizens of the modern world, rather than fall back on atavistic ways. If our ancestors of tens of thousands of years ago were here today, they could learn French or use the computer as easily as you or I. On the flip side, if you or I were born back in their time, then our brain's world would be limited to the woolly beasts and campfires surrounding us. There would be no nerve cell circuitries to debate the merits of modern art or the conundrum of quantum physics. But if what's in here is a reflection of what's out there, how do we ever change? How do we get from the agricultural revolution to the industrial revolution? Or from ancient Egypt to modern Manhattan? Well, the answer does lie in the brain. Actually, in the brain's complexity. Most of this complexity lies in the cortex, the wrinkled layer that covers the brain surface. Though less than a quarter inch thick, the cortex is the brain's crowning glory. Among its roles, the cortex is our reality check. It filters and orders the outside world for us and allows us to see, touch, hear, and speak. The cortex is also the human thinking cap. All our plans, thoughts, and ideas originate in this layer. The cortex is packed with nerve cells. About two-thirds of all our neurons operate here. A piece of cortex tissue, no larger than a pinhead, can house 30,000 of these cells. Each neuron has a job, to communicate with other neurons. The brain works by forming networks among these cells. The long, spiny branches of the networks create a neural forest of astounding intricacy. Neurons use these communication lines to talk to each other with electric and chemical signals. Here under microscope are two neurons linking up. Though it may look like they fuse together, neurons don't actually touch each other. A closer look reveals that a tiny gap, called a synapse, separates their branches. This is where a message passes from one neuron to the next. The message comes from here, small sacs that store chemical molecules. When stimulated, these sacs release their molecules, which cross the cell membrane into the synaptic gap. An electric zap allows this to happen. Meantime, the receiving neuron has special welcome sites for the incoming molecules. These receptor sites bind with the molecules. When they do, special gates open up. The gates let in a flood of charged particles, sodium and potassium ions, which start up a new electrical signal in the receiving neuron. This simple chain of events, an electrical zap, followed by chemical changes, followed by another electrical zap, is the basis of all brain activity. It's how neurons speak to each other. Here, then, is the key to the brain's complexity. There are 100 billion neurons in the brain. Each neuron, like a bit player in a grand production, processes its information, then hooks up with as many as 50,000 other neurons to send and receive messages. 100 billion neurons times 50,000 connections. It's this complexity that allows us to think imaginatively. On their own, neurons aren't very bright. But put 100 billion of them together in a small space and let them all start talking to each other, and you start to get brainstorms. The brain takes off on its own, really, in spontaneous and unpredictable ways, without waiting for instructions or input from the outside world. The trillions of neural networks, like an improvisational orchestra, create new ideas and connect different thoughts in a whimsical and sometimes inspired fashion. It's this impromptu ability to produce new things in our brains that allows us to progress, that quite simply takes us from here to here. We weren't born with all these fantastical neural networks in place. In fact, we create them as we experience life, as we grow up. In the womb, the fetal brain is already fast at work. Its neurons multiply at an awesome rate to about 200 billion after the first few months. They are, in fact, overproduced, a biological insurance policy. About half of these cells simply die off. For the half that survive, the job is just beginning. Because compared with other animals, humans are born extremely immature. As adorable as human babies may be, they need years of development before they can skillfully negotiate their way through the world. Our most important asset is our brain. From birth, it takes on the world with an almost explosive force, rapidly forming trillions of neural connections. What forces guide this developing network? The answer is everything around us. The brain is not a static, hardwired piece of machinery, as once was thought. It's a dynamic creation that constantly shapes and reshapes itself. Our genes supply the parameters for how neurons connect. They lay down a foundation of sorts. But in large measure, the neural connections, the basis of all brain activity, are modeled by the things we encounter in the outside world. The environment physically changes our brain. Over time, as a child has reinforcing experiences, the brain develops territories. It draws certain neural maps for functions like vision, language, muscle movement, and hearing. But the brain sets deadlines for creating these neural maps. If we aren't exposed to language or vision or sounds at crucial periods in our development, those neural circuits are reassigned to other tasks, and our ability to speak, see, or hear is forever limited. A child's drawing may seem simple, but the process of putting these rudimentary images on paper may help her form neural connections of enormous complexity and shape the way she sees the world for life. The young brain's ability to rapidly shift its neural networks sometimes provides children with enviable powers.
Have you ever wondered why children find it so much easier than grown-ups to learn to speak a second language or play a musical instrument? Well, fast and easy neural connections provide some of the answer. A young brain is extremely elastic. It can realign neurons at a pace no adult could ever match.
Here's what it looks like under microscope. On the left are the neurons of a young mouse. On the right, the neurons of an older mouse. Notice the speed with which the neurons on the left reconnect compared with the older ones. The young brain is more resilient and responds to new information with greater efficiency. Hence, the ability to learn new things so quickly. As we grow up, our neural networking gradually slows down. By age 10, we become a little more hardwired. Although these neural circuits will stay somewhat flexible, the brain has pretty much selected a value system for itself. It's discovered what's good and useful in the outside world. And these values become reflected in the brain's neural architecture. During the time the brain's been creating and selecting neural networks, it's also been rejecting. The developing brain weeds out unnecessary connections. It prunes its neural forest considerably, allowing only those nerve cell circuits reinforced by experience to stay put. The others are broken down.
I'm sitting next to a machine that can read minds. Well, sort of. It's called a functional MRI, and it uses radio waves to record chemical changes in the brain while we're thinking and moving. What you get really is a home movie of the brain in action.
In this cutting-edge experiment, the person was asked to think about and then practice a finger tapping exercise. The areas in orange show which part of his brain is learning to do the task. As the person practices, the area grows. Not surprisingly, this section of the brain handles nearly all of our muscle movements. New brain imaging techniques are allowing researchers to see in living color how the brain is organized. For example, this area in blue is the primary visual cortex, where we process all incoming visual information. Without it, we'd be blind. This thin strip is the sensory area, where we experience the sensation of touch. Next to it, the motor cortex. Amazing to think that this tiny area is responsible for producing all voluntary muscle movement, for creating the world's greatest athletes and dancers. The brain also has two special language areas, located only on the left side of the cortex. All our words come from here. Large portions of the cortex don't have a set function. These areas are called association zones. They do much of our classifying, distilling, and ordering of information. The association zones spend a lot of time talking to themselves and to other areas in the brain. So far, we haven't been able to accurately map these conversations, but we're getting closer. We know a little bit now about the communication lines between neurons, that they are powered with electricity. We also know that the messages neurons exchange are chemical molecules trapped inside these holding tanks until an electrical signal frees them. The molecules that move from one neuron to the next are called neurotransmitters. In the last decade, we detected transmitters that carry messages about pain and pleasure, about sadness and joy, about stress and relaxation. Early experience plays a vital role in brain chemistry. Just as neural networks form in response to how we grow up, so are the levels of neurotransmitters set, in part, by our upbringing. No one knows how many of these molecules of mood reside in the brain. There could be hundreds. So far, fewer than 50 have been identified. Serotonin is one of them. It's the brain's workhorse molecule, playing numerous roles, not the least of which is to inhibit our violent tendencies. Noradrenaline plays a Paul Revere kind of role. It sounds the alarm about threats from the outside world and prepares us for fight or flight. Substance P is a molecule that carries messages about pain. In a sense, substance P is what prompts us to cry, ouch. Conversely, our brains produce painkillers, called endogenous morphines or endorphins. Neurotransmitters play a critical role in normal functioning, and yet it's easy to disrupt our chemical equilibrium. If electrical impulses go awry in the brain, the chemical transactions that are so dependent on them also go haywire. Mood disorders and mental illness can result. Change the level of a single neurotransmitter, and it could upset the chemical balance of the entire brain.
Sometimes I wonder where all of this scientific inquiry may be taking us. As we learn more about how the human brain works, are we reducing the actions of humans to so many mechanical and chemical forces? Takes us right up to the edge, doesn't it, of how we really see ourselves. I mean, do I really want to know that my loftiest thoughts, my most intimate dreams, are merely the result of sodium and potassium currents, or the product of some molecule whose name I can't pronounce? If I'm feeling timid, I'm reassured by some of the leading members of the neuroscience community who are walking right up to this precarious precipice. One that might throw us into existential freefall or lead us to some higher ground from which to view ourselves.
Sunny Southern California, not the place you'd expect to find the greatest scientists of our time. Then again, this is the Salk Institute for Biological Studies in La Jolla. Here, the brightest minds are searching for the scientific basis of consciousness in the brain.
Well, some people are worried because they think that if you explain how the brain works by the firing of neurons and all the other processes going on involving atoms and molecules, that will somehow diminish them. And it certainly, I think, will change their view of themselves. But you have to realize the brain is extraordinarily complicated.
Why should we try to understand consciousness? Well, I guess because in many ways it's a sort of central mystery of human life. I am struck by the fact that I can fall asleep at night, and in a certain sense, I don't exist. And I wake up in the morning, and there I am.
They could weasel out of that one.
Patricia Churchland and Francis Crick dedicate their days to understanding how the brain works so that they can eventually map the mind. Professor Churchland is both a philosopher and a cognitive scientist. She divides her time between examining the brain and addressing the philosophical questions that arise with every new discovery of what it does. She is joined by Professor Crick, who has spent the last two decades studying neuroscience. 40 years ago, Francis Crick made history when he co-discovered the molecular structure of DNA, the famed double helix. It was an achievement for which he and partner James Watson received a Nobel Prize. Not one to shy away from new challenges, the 78-year-old Crick is striving to unravel the mystery of consciousness. He has focused his investigation on neurons, particularly in how they fire in relation to one another. In his book, The Astonishing Hypothesis, Professor Crick contends that all aspects of existence can be explained by neurons.
Well, the astonishing hypothesis really is that everything about you in the sense of your feelings, what you see, what you hear, what you do, are due to the action of nerve cells inside your brain. And it's not a new hypothesis. Essentially, Hippocrates, about 400 BC, said it was all in the brain. And it's not astonishing to most neuroscientists because that's what they generally believe. It is astonishing, perhaps, to many other people.
Research on macaque monkeys gave Professor Crick a useful starting point for studying consciousness. He focused on their brain's visual systems, which resemble our own. Professor Crick wanted to know what were the mechanisms that produced a single aspect of consciousness, what he called visual awareness, that is, being aware of what you see around you. After years of data gathering, Professor Crick was able to advance a theory about how visual awareness works. Put simply, the theory states that particular neurons, perhaps in different parts of the brain, fire simultaneously as we become visually aware of an object. The neurons fire not only together, but also at a particular frequency of 40 hertz, or 40 times per second. These neurons must stay phase locked for a certain length of time while they fire. So the theory goes, when we look at something, when our attention is focused, selected neurons fire in a particular pattern that makes us conscious of what we see. Taking the theory another step, Crick suggests this simultaneous firing may be the underlying mechanism for other forms of consciousness as well.
The idea is that at this frequency of 40 cycles per second, neurons in different places are all firing on the beat of the 40 cycles, like a conductor, as if there were a conductor keeping them all firing together. They don't fire every time, but when they would fire on the beat. That's the hypothesis. Whether it's true remains to be seen.
As a philosopher, I was very interested in the kinds of questions about the mind that philosophers had traditionally been interested in. I wanted to understand the nature of consciousness. I wanted to understand how it is that we think and reason, what visual imagery is, and so on. And the more I sort of wrestled with those questions within the philosophical context, the more I realized that I needed to branch out from that context. Now, is that partly, too, because of its connectivity, but also partly because of...
Like Professor Crick, Patricia Churchland believes the mystery of the mind will eventually be solved by unscrambling the brain.
Understanding the nuts and bolts of the brain, how the individual components work, how they interact with one another, is going to be crucial if we're to understand things like how we plan, how we make decisions, why it is that sometimes we make bad decisions, and so forth.
There are enormous numbers of neurons, and they're interacting in very complicated ways. And you're studying the interactions. Rather than degrading our opinions of ourselves, it should make us do two things. First of all, understand much better what's going on in our brains when we see things and do things and so on. And it should give us a feeling of enormous awe that this little apparatus inside our head can do all that.
It took 500 million years of evolution before the human brain finally made its debut on the world scene. 500 million years to add layer upon layer of change. We've unraveled only some of its mysteries in the last 10. In thinking about what is commonly called a 3-pound universe, I'm struck most by the nature of its evolution. Not through history, but through the course of one's own lifetime. During the first 10 years especially, experiences can actually mold and shape the brain, design the neural architecture, and determine the level of chemicals. On the one hand, I'm thrilled because the brain's second evolution, during our own lifetime, frees us from the shackles of our ancestry. We are not predestined creatures. Any one of us could evolve in countless ways. That's a most liberating thought. But I wonder, does what we know about the brain's second evolution suggest that instead of being prisoners of our genes, we are molded by the world around us? Maybe it means that we aren't free at all, that we're simply prisoners of our environment. It's chilling to know that the brain is so vulnerable to external influences, to poverty, violence, hatred, prejudice,
We might almost wish that genes had more influence to buffer the brain. But in fact, life's tragedies profoundly and inalterably affect the brain, physically change it. What a grave picture to ponder. It begins to give us a scientific understanding of why prejudice and ethnic hostilities can persist for centuries, why violence begets violence.
We know these images all too well. We have seen far too often how hatred and terror can turn families into grief-stricken mourners. Whose vows of revenge pass on to the youth. Not far from this scene, an anthropologist discovered the roots of our humanity in a land now bloody with acts of inhumanity. The stresses to heart and soul are unimaginable, but the toll on the brain may be the most disturbing. Physically changed as an adaptation to the environment, the brain may eventually make violent behavior even more likely. Though he may never return to Shanidar, Dr. Solecki finds compassion has not completely disappeared, and beauty can be found if we seek it. Years ago, in the cave at Shanidar, a Neanderthal family mourned its dead, placing flowers in their graves. And from that touching, eloquent act, we can trace the rise of religion and ritual, myth and metaphor, the things that make the human a source of joy and wonder. In his notebook, Dr. Solecki jotted down a parting thought. 60,000 years ago, the Neanderthals placed flowers on their dead and showed compassion for the weak. When we are able to take another look at what we call humanity, our civilization holds the possibility of becoming something beautiful, like the flowers of Shanidar. On the next episode of The Brain, Our Universe Within, visual perception. The manipulation of countless points of light reveals a world uniquely our own. For the artist, seeing is a way of life. But it is the brain, not the eyes, that sees. Thanks to a complex network of activity that shuffles and codes the jumble of information that makes up our world. How does the brain bring order out of today's chaotic stimuli? Why do we each see the world differently? Find out on Perception, the next episode of The Brain, Our Universe Within. You won't believe your eyes.
How in the world do we make sense of the world? We do it with something called perception. I've lived in North America all my life. To my friends and colleagues, I'm considered Japanese. But when I'm here in Japan, people know instantly I'm a foreigner before I even utter a word. Our culture has a big part in creating our perceptions. But it all starts up here. The brain, actually, physically constructs and colors a world for us. The brain takes the chaos out here and orders it in a way it decides will be most useful for us, allowing us to see, smell, and hear certain things. But how does the brain do that? We're about to find out. I'm David Suzuki, and I'm going to show you how the world up here shapes the way we perceive the world out there, and what it means to see and not see.
Our eyes may be the front doors to vision, but strangely enough, they aren't where sight happens. All our senses really happen back here, in the strange, mysterious folds of the brain. Motionless and dead silent, it's racing to make thousands of lightning-fast decisions every second of every day. The world of art bears a fascinating truth about brain study. Each of us sees the world differently. Vision, or visual perception in the brain, is a unique experience. You and I may look at the same thing, but thanks to our brains, we see it differently. We begin this journey into the brain where we'll see how we see in an artist's studio. It's a place where seeing is a way of life. Bold, vibrant, larger than life. Tetsushi Iwashita's paintings demonstrate the power of the brain to create a personal picture of the world. Tetchan's vision is especially personal because he sees with only half of his brain. At 15 months, Tetchan suffered a terrible fever, which damaged his brain's right hemisphere and paralyzed the left side of his body. The fever also left the young boy with learning disabilities. Today, he has learned to cope with the outward physical effects of the damage to his brain. But it's the artworks, begun at an early age, that most interest us. They are expressive reflections of the world he sees, of the colors and textures that captivate him. These paintings, these worlds begun with the gentle guidance of a brush on paper, are windows into the mysterious workings of the brain, Tetchan's, yours, and mine. Today, Tetchan will see his brain for the first time with magnetic resonance imaging, or MRI. It uses a strong magnetic field and radio waves to map out an image of the brain. It shows the badly damaged right side of Tetchan's brain, but the left hemisphere has grown larger toward the right, perhaps to compensate for the damage there. Though Tetchan's eyes function normally with 20/20 vision, his brain does not. And it's his brain, not his eyes, that actually creates the images he sees. tests measuring his field of vision, and remember, his eyes are 20/20 accurate, point to the role the brain plays in seeing. This is the visual field of a normal person. Each eye scans a broad circular field. Tetchan sees with both eyes, but the damage to his brain has cut the visual field of each in half. A computer-assisted eye camera simulates the way Tetchan sees by blocking portions of his field of vision and responding to his eye movements. It's a miraculous device that takes us into Tetchan's remarkably difficult visual world. Only by scanning with his eyes much more than the average person can Tetchan see the whole picture. The brain takes information from the left and right fields of vision and reads them separately. Information from the right side of the visual field is reflected on the right half of the retina and then conveyed to the left side of the brain for processing. It's just the opposite for the other side. Tetchan's damaged right brain can't read what's on the left half of the field. The incoming signals have nowhere to go. ...128 separate cross-sectional images of Tetchan's brain were used in this three-dimensional reconstruction. It shows the devastating effects of his high childhood fever and a brief related coma. Tetchan's brain, like all of ours, constantly works to build and interpret the images coming in through the eyes. These images are simply countless points of light. It's only the center of the visual field that we see sharply. We take in the whole, like Tetchan, by moving our eyes, thereby shifting the readable center. This complex split-second process, which each of us performs thousands of times a day, produces the world as we see it. We use both eyes to perceive depth. When we focus on the sunflower in front, each eye also sees the flowers in the background, but each from a slightly different perspective. It looks like this from the left eye, and like this from the right. The brain then calculates the difference between these two viewpoints and perceives depth. Now let's travel deeper into the mysterious folds of the brain to see how meaningful images are created. It starts when incoming light is converted to electricity by these strange devices called rods and cones. Kiki, whom your eyes are gathering now, will help us with the rest of the trip.
Amina!
First, incoming light information is flipped upside down. Next, the information breaks up into fragments. Then, at the crossroads of the visual fields, it splits. Sorry, Kiki. The fragmented pieces then make their way to the primary visual cortex found at the back of the brain. This layered region filters and codes the information. Now Kiki's trip gets even more complicated. All that coded information is parceled out to as many as 32 locations for finer processing. The cerebral cortex, The brain's quarter-inch thick thinking cap consists of tightly packed columns of nerve cells. It's the number of columns and their complex web of neurons that set us apart from other animals. What makes us human, in fact. Here, we finally see the world. Inside each column, neurons form networks of fierce activity. Each neuron, through its numerous branches, sends or receives electrical messages from neighboring neurons. The messages fly over connections called synapses, seen in red. Without these crucial links, information couldn't travel throughout the brain. A single neuron may have thousands of synapses, so a single column may contain millions of these transfer points. It makes for some rich and complex conversations among brain cells. Information continually bombards the brain. To manage it, the cortex uses the division of labor principle. Here, neurons begin sorting the still jumbled scene. We know Kiki is in there somewhere. Every column has a complete set of neurons, each designed to seek out a specific angle from 0 to 180 degrees that might be found in the various shapes within the scene. It's a bit like finding the edges of a jigsaw puzzle first. As the process continues, thousands of lightning-fast tasks rage beneath the brain's surface. It's a race to make the round edges sharp, to find in the incomprehensible jumble something or someone we recognize. Eventually, the outlines of a face appear. All of these visual bits and pieces are processed and coded by assigned neurons. While one set of neurons is busy reading the contour of a cheekbone, another will read the shape of the eyes or the slant of the nose. It's an incredibly evolved bit of natural computing. And at the end of this split-second journey, when everything is reassembled, a familiar image appears. So many combinations. Experts speculate that the brain builds on what it learns while processing simple patterns, enabling it to perceive increasingly complex shapes or other forms of information. This epilepsy patient is about to undergo a miraculous procedure. While doctors operate on her brain, she will actually remain conscious in order to answer a battery of questions. The questions will be about her vision, so we'll be able to see the process of sight at work in a living brain. As you might have guessed, the procedure focuses on the brain's electrical activity. Electrodes, tiny probes which measure electrical activity, will be placed in the brain. Blood vessels must be given a wide berth, but because the brain has no nerve endings, the patient will feel no pain. The electrodes are placed in particular sites of the temporal lobe, where visual information is processed. While the patient watches a screen in front of her, she is asked which of the three lettered shapes matches the one on top. The probes should identify which cell contains the neurons involved in determining the shape shown. This cell reacted to the slanted line.
A. Stirring. Break. C.
As the shapes become more complex, and she is finally shown faces, many different cells responded. The ability to see and recognize faces, a rather sophisticated task, calls on entire systems of neural networks. So, accurate pictures emerged for the patient as information swept through her cortex. But exactly how this information is reassembled remains a riddle. When just part of a processing system is damaged, the result can be quite peculiar.
Let's try the next one. What about him?
It may be another politician. It looks like Prime Minister Tanaka.
Kakue Tanaka, you think? I see.
Yes, it's the longish teeth.
Longish teeth, I see. What about the hairstyle?
I haven't seen Kakue Tanaka recently.
Do you know if it's a woman or a man?
It's a man.
You don't remember seeing this shirt before?
No, I don't think so.
It's you, Mr. Soda, though. This was taken quite a while ago.
It is? I don't recognize it. I don't even recognize my own picture. Is this really me? Look at all these wrinkles.
The damage to Mr. Isoda's brain left him without the ability to access the who and sometimes the what of an object. Damage to other parts of the visual system led to different, unusual problems. This woman suffered a stroke 14 years ago. Now her view of the world is dramatically skewed. She cannot detect how full the glass gets. She sees the water, but she doesn't see the water rising. She can no longer detect motion. The stroke interrupted the neural pathways that process motion, the where of the visual scene. Hers is the only reported case of its kind. The world her brain sees for her is terribly disjointed. Simply watching a car pass by can be a frightening experience. She sees in freeze frame. Her physical world is made up of disjointed still images, like the pictures on a film reel, except there are large gaps between each of them. A mere stroll down the street can be terrifying, for there are so many moving objects to understand in those flashing still frames. And many of those moving objects could hurt her. When both she and the object she is looking at are moving, things get even worse. It probably looks something like this. When just one of the many parts of the brain's visual system is impaired, our view can be dramatically altered. But the human brain, even when damaged, has a remarkable ability to adapt. When one sense fails, we can learn to rely on another.
Thank you.
Frequent field trips to observe the subjects he will paint are a part of Tetchan's creative routine. They demonstrate one of his most intriguing adaptive skills. Animals like these skittish seagulls can only be observed from a distance. Close observation and physical contact are impossible. Later, the gulls clearly lack the spirit and texture of his other works. So whenever possible, Tetchan makes up for what his brain can't see for him by touching. It's an active process of scanning with his fingers, much as he or any of us scans with his eyes. This adaptation, this supplementing one damaged sense with another, is a fundamental technique in Tetchan's work. Sight and touch are integrated as he studies a subject, locks an image in memory, and then paints it in one single intense session. Tetchan's art is a triumph over disability. His method is a fascinating demonstration of the brain's ability to adapt. But it's not all in the head. Here, Tetchan's heart clearly plays a role. It's an intimate and tactile relationship between artist, subject, and the work itself. Here's how touch works. Special cells in the skin convert touch into electrical signals that are sent to the spinal cord and up to the brain. All information about touch is first sent to a thin strip of cortex. This little strip is actually a detailed map of the body. But it's a distorted map. The brain gives certain parts of the body priority, like the hands, the face, the lips, the tongue.
If we were to reconstruct our body according to this neural map, we would look a bit warped. Our fingers would grow huge, as would our lips and tongue. No two neural maps are alike, though. They reflect our individual development and experiences. Braille readers, for example, gather information through the touch of their fingertips, and so that area in the cortex grows larger. It actually takes over other sections of the map. We're beginning to see, then, how the maps in our brain can construct a kind of personalized view of the world. How we take the physical stuff out there, the light waves, particles, and matter, and make them mean something. That's also what we do with sound.
Sound is purely mechanical, produced by physical vibrations. The outer ear gathers and funnels sound waves into the eardrum, causing it to vibrate. These vibrations rattle the bones in the middle ear that connect to the cochlea. This is where the vibrations are translated into electrical impulses. These signals then travel along a number of interwoven pathways to the auditory cortex and beyond. The cells in the auditory cortex respond to discrete features of sounds. Some neurons respond to pitch, others to volume, and others to direction. Now the process starts to look familiar. Just as with the visual impulses, which we saw earlier, assigned neurons start coding and recoding all the bits and pieces of sound information. where before they started to outline what the eyes had transmitted, here they work to define what the ears have sent. Similar processes are underway to make sense of other information the ear gathers here. Remember how the brain coordinated both eyes to create depth perception? Well, now it's processing data from each ear to determine the location of certain sounds. This is all pretty standard stuff for the way most of us hear.
Come on, everybody.
But this man, Leslie Lemke, hears like very few people on Earth. Right now, he's reciting verbatim a boxing match he heard only once.
Bullseye. There he is.
Leslie is well known for his prodigious gift of music and memory. Mentally retarded and blind, he is shut off from much of our world. But sounds break through and are music to his ears. Leslie's adoptive mother recognized his gift early, and his life has centered around music ever since. He has never seen a sheet of music, and he's never been formally trained, but you'd never know it.
Listen carefully.
He can replay any song after only one hearing. Leslie has a heightened sense of hearing. His body and brain block much of the incoming sensory traffic, but sounds he absorbs in volumes. Sounds that blend into the background he discriminates, pays attention to, and marvels at. Discerning listeners note a lack of nuance in his music. In fact, Leslie's music is probably not an interpretation of what he has heard, but a recitation, a bit like reading poetry as if it were prose. But in the comfort of certain familiar surroundings, when friends have gathered near and family has drawn close by your side, none of that seems to matter very much.
Try this. See what you think.
Okay. It's very citrusy.
Yes. It evokes a very invigorating feeling. Other than only citruses, there are fruits in it, there are melons, there are flowers. There are maybe close or more than 1,000 ingredients in the base you're smelling right now.
The perfumer knows the power of a scent.
In the world of human perception, our sense of smell tends to take a back seat. After all, we walk upright and our noses are far off the ground. But every time I smell a certain perfume, vivid memories of a high school love come flooding back. It's as if my sense of smell has opened a door onto the past.
In evolution, the oldest of them all is the sense of smell. Interestingly, it is also the first to develop in the womb. The flavors of foods mothers consume have been detected in the amniotic fluid. Perhaps the unborn child is bonding with its mother in the womb through smell, gaining experience about mother's diet and her olfactory identity. A newborn shows a variety of responses to smells difficult for adults to detect. such as the precise smell of its mother's breast. We rely on the sense of smell at this stage more than we ever will again. Odor molecules sniffed through the nose or pumped up the tongue and cheeks into the nasal cavity are picked up by cilia or tiny hair-like projections of the olfactory neurons. There, the smells are translated into electrical signals. These signals are sent directly to the olfactory bulbs. With only one synapse to cross, the pathway is almost an open road to the brain. Though they are spread throughout the cortex, olfactory neurons have particular circuits wired to the limbic system. That's where our emotions sit. And to the endocrine system, where hormones are produced. Because of these special links, we can think of smell as the most excitable of our senses. With the sense of smell, we sniff out foods we like and dislike. Smells produce cravings. They arouse, stimulate, and frighten. They also send warnings about things that are otherwise undetectable, like leaking gas or spoiled food. Thanks to the strong emotional link associated with smells, we don't easily forget negative experiences, like getting sick from certain foods. The smell alone can trigger symptoms of nausea, lest we forget and give the food another try. The last sense through which the brain receives information from the outside world is taste. The receptors on the tongue are geared for picking up just four basic qualities of taste: salty, sour, bitter, and sweet. All the more subtle tastes we experience are largely a function of smell. Our bodies need certain foods, yet our eating habits are mostly learned, a result of tradition and culture. These food preferences are built up and stored in the brain's memory bank, spread in neural networks throughout the cortex. So even though we might not be aware of it, our brains use their stores of memory to determine what foods we select to eat. There's still a great unsolved mystery locked deep within the brain. We know that information bits sweep through the cortex in such a way that a clear perception emerges. But no one has proved how or where exactly this information gets assembled. Dr. Antonio Damasio is a leading neurologist at the University of Iowa Hospital. While some search for a final assembly point for perception impulses, he's not so sure there is such a place.
You probably don't need to have a place where it all comes together. In fact, I don't think there's any evidence anatomically that an image of sound, like the image of my voice now in your brain, or the visual image that you're now having of the scene, that they ever will coalesce together in the same structure. I don't think there's any evidence for that. I think that what you have evidence for is that they can be temporally synchronized. And there is evidence that there are structures that have signals that hail from those respective images. And therefore, there's a linkage. But the linkage is not made at the level of the image itself. So it's not my image of your face together with my image of your voice in the same cortex. I think that those remain separate, but they can be brought online at the same time.
Currents of data feed forward throughout the brain and then loop back, from sensory areas to memory centers and back again. Based on new imaging techniques like functional MRI and PET scan, many researchers now believe that perhaps these parallel networks bind together in synchrony, a kind of harmonic convergence to produce what we call perception.
So I have all this activity going on that is representing you in perception right now. And what my brain is actually storing is not your picture, but rather the mechanisms that are being utilized to create the perception of you. And tomorrow, when people ask me about you, I'm going to go into those mechanisms, and I'm going to try to make them do the same thing that they're doing today. And then they're going to generate an image that is not going to be quite the same as seeing you right now, but it's going to have a lot in common with what it is being done today. So what I'm going to have is an attempt at replicating the patterns of activity of today. And during that period, I create an image, and I bring on lots of other images that pertain to you.
Sensory data constantly stream into the brain. Our brain attaches associations and memories to allow us to make sense of what we see, hear, and touch before us. We perceive the world as a constant, unified place. And that's because the brain acts as a filter. But what if the barrage of information pours in unabated? That's the world of the autistic. Their systems don't properly control the information sent to the brain by their sense organs, so almost everything gets in simultaneously. Their experience of the world has been likened to watching a television whose channels all come in at once. Clamoring, relentless sensations overwhelm, and as a coping mechanism, their bodies often just shut down. That cruel, tortured existence isn't a life sentence for all autistics. There have been some remarkable journeys back to peace and normalcy. Temple Grandin is an assistant professor of animal science at Colorado State University. She's known around the country as a livestock handling systems designer. Dr. Grandin is autistic. With the help of her family and with intense progressive therapy, Temple slowly emerged from the confusing sensory overload that had shut her off from the rest of the world. It was a journey of startling revelations.
When I was a child, you know, some of my biggest concerns were dealing with sensory problems. Now, I didn't realize that other people's, you know, hearing was less sensitive. I thought, well, maybe I just wasn't a strong enough person. You know, it was only, you know, maybe 7 or 8 years ago that I realized the full extent of how sensitive my hearing was compared to everybody else's. But I spent an awful lot of time worrying about things that were going to scare me, like the school bell going off. I mean, that school bell, when it rang, that just hurt my ears, like a dentist drill going up the ear.
Touch is a paradox for Temple.
You know, they want it, but then they don't. This is the same way I was. I wanted to feel a nice feeling of being held, but then it was just too overwhelming. One of the reasons why the autistic child withdraws is because his sensory systems are bombarding him with so much stimuli, he can't stand it. It would sort of be like being inside a pinball machine, being bounced around, bombarded with light, sound, and touch sensations.
When she was 18, Temple got an ingenious idea. She built a home version of one of these, what the cattle industry refers to as a squeeze chute.
I got the idea from that, from the squeeze chute used on the cattle. And I noticed that when some cattle were put in there, pressure tended to relax them. If you didn't squeeze them, they would tend to jump around and get upset. And I saw that and I thought, well, maybe that helped calm me down. I mean, basically, it's like a padded version of a squeeze chute. Completely foam rubber padded on the inside, get in here like this, head through here, and when I pull on this lever, it will squeeze me. I can control the amount of pressure. See, one of the problems I had when I was a child is I couldn't stand to be touched. And what therapists are doing now is they work on desensitizing the child. You work on gradually encouraging more and more and more touch. When I first built this, I would pull away from it. But the fact that I could control it, if it got to be too intense, then I could stop it. See, I can control the amount of pressure. I pull the handle towards me, it squeezes. If I push it away, it lets go. When I get in here, I get really calm and I get to where, you know, I don't want to talk very much.
Human communication demands a high level of synthesis, with many signals coming in at once. Temple's brain has trouble processing the complexities of extended contact with people.
Animals are much easier. I mean, before a bull charges, he gives you definite signs, like pawing the ground. I mean, the cattle give you definite signs. Like someone might say to me, aren't you worried about getting stepped on? Well, you know, none of them were showing any aggressive behavior. Now, there were a couple of animals that were butting each other to each other, and if they got to doing too much of that, I'd get out of the way. But animals will give you very clear-cut signals as of what they want. You hear these cattle bellowing? See the feed trucks going up there, and they know the feed truck's coming. And see, they're going up to the feed truck. They're telling you exactly what they want. You know, they're easier to figure out.
They seem to like her pretty well, too. Her affinity with cattle is genuine and probably unique. It's certainly an important factor in her success as a designer of equipment used to manage them. If we didn't know her story, it might look awfully peculiar. But it's really a victory over a terror most of us can only imagine. And it's all been determined by how she viewed the world. That is, how her brain tamed the unruly sensory information it received. Its wonders exhaust the imagination. This man's childhood fever set him on a path filled with challenges of the most basic sort. But remarkable adaptations in what remains of his brain have made for a purposeful and apparently happy life. In a world of subjects that compel him to paint, we are richer for his interpretations. At Tet Chan's annual exhibition, new and active eyes feast on his vision of the world. That vision is based on complicated functions his brain performs to make sense of his surroundings. Our brains, just like Tetchan's, create and deliver all that we know of the world around us. From infancy, we build maps of experience. These maps for seeing, tasting, and touching, for memory and emotion, these maps, when similar from person to person, are what bring individuals together into a society or culture. Our perceptions are often shared, but our brains also make them uniquely our own.
Amazing to think that the physical universe around us is deconstructed, then reconstructed by this inner universe called the brain, and that these perceptions become, in fact, our reality. Long ago, my brain told me to appreciate a hot dog with mustard, but to avoid the relish. Long ago, it had no experience of the seafood delicacies here in Japan. The neural maps in here come to reflect our culture. I've learned to enjoy relish and Japanese seafood. If my brain lacks or reflects certain values, I can add or change some of them. And even if my neural networks don't look like your neural networks, does it really make me that different from you? Is my wiring somehow better or worse than yours? For the Discovery Channel, I'm David Suzuki.
Discovery Channel and the Chrysler Corporation are proud to bring you the best in quality documentary television. This presentation of The Brain is presented in partnership with Chrysler Plymouth and Jeep Eagle, divisions of the Chrysler Corporation.